Welcome to the Popcorn Talk Network, for the online broadcast network that features movie discussion, news, and interviews. Press one.
Popcorn Talk. We talk movies. From the Popcorn Talk Network, the online broadcast network for movie talk, this is Inside the Documentary, featuring breakdowns and interviews about all the latest documentaries.
Hello and welcome to Popcorn Talks, Inside the Documentary, where we'll be discussing the trials and tribulations of documentary filmmaking. I'm your host, Kristen Elizabeth Snyder, and you can follow me at Cinematic Escape, and joining me...
Joining you is Isaiah Castañeda, and you guys can reach me at Castañeda_Isa on Twitter. And
joining them, my name's Ryan Malady. How's it going? You guys can keep up with me at Ryan Malady.
And I'm Bobby DeMuro. You guys can follow me on Twitter at Bobby DeMuro.
And of course, you guys can follow the Popcorn Talk Network at The Popcorn Talk on Twitter. We're on YouTube at youtube.com/popcorntalknetwork. And you can go to popcorntalk.com and watch us live right now. You can call into the show at 424-253-0504. And today we're discussing Thom Andersen's film, Los Angeles Plays Itself. Now, this film, you know, has gotten a lot of attention. Los Angeles is the backdrop for the movie industry, and it tends to shape, you know, how people see Los Angeles, the scape of it, the past, the future of it. I think we all have come from other places to be in this industry, and being out here, a lot of the real world is mixed with the fantasy out here, and some of us feel like we're always on a movie set. So I was excited to watch this film. What was sort of the initial reactions for you guys?
I'll take it. For me, I was fine with the film, you know, for the first 20 minutes. After the first 20 minutes, I was kind of out. I thought, you know, Andersen was just kind of generalizing or kind of putting people in a bubble. Mm-hmm. Like, if you're from LA, you have the right to speak about LA or Los Angeles. I'm sorry.
Yeah, don't call it LA.
Don't abbreviate my city.
So that's basically, you know, what I got for the film. After that, you know, I understand his background. I kind of understand his point of view, but I don't agree with it.
It's difficult for him to, in this industry as a filmmaker, he almost likened to make himself outside the industry and saying, oh, well, you know, only one of 40 people in LA works in their industry. The rest of us, those were direct words, the rest of us don't. You're a filmmaker, Thom. You're in this industry. Mm-hmm. However you want to define how in you are, you made this film, you're in this industry. You can't then criticize the industry and criticize the way LA is portrayed as part of the industry, but you say, oh, I'm above it, I'm different. No. You're in it. What would have been valuable is if you, Thom, had gone to the other 39 out of 40 and asked them about the industry. Ask the factory workers and the taxi cab drivers and those people. Talk to them about the industry. Mm-hmm. I'll pay attention more from that regard. Really interesting archive footage, really interesting points along the way that we'll talk about, but really broadly, you can't separate yourself from the industry. You're part of it.
That's a great point. Absolutely. How did you feel, Ryan?
I thought it was beautifully made. And, you know, I'm actually just a recent resident of LA. I moved out here about 6 months ago from Colorado. And so watching it with the virgin eyes of an LA, you know, native, Los Angeles, that's the thing. Who turned Los Angeles into LA.
Right.
He has such a disdain for LA and such a love for Los Angeles that I was sitting here watching both sides of the fence, standing on it, trying not to fall one way or the other. Mm-hmm. And it really did open my eyes to the history of Los Angeles and what it's become, which is now LA. And I enjoyed it, even though he was such a hater the whole time. Well, I think I enjoyed it more that he was hating on all these films and their portrayal of his city than if he was loving on it. Because it's almost, you can sense his pain. Yeah. And pain is what makes something enjoyable to watch sometimes.
Absolutely. And, you know, I want to pinpoint on the fact that it's not that he hates Los Angeles. He's defending Los Angeles.
Right. He
doesn't like the way the city is portrayed in film, because all that people know who don't live here, or even actually the locals who do live here and the rest of the world, they only really know what is shown to them in the movies. That's their perception of LA. And for a lot of us, I think that that still is our perception. I know, like, the curtain close or opens rather eventually once you get here and you've been here a while and you start to see more of the truths behind the city. But I mean, you can choose to see the fantasies that fuel the city, or you can see the unhealthy cynicism. And in this regard, I think that he was seeing the unhealthy cynicism, but at the same time, he was asking for a movement. He was asking for more neo-realism. He was asking for our culture and society to start making change. I know in the film he went on rants about the workers and whatnot, but what he was really saying there is, you know, the unwind of the traditional man having traditional jobs and the fact that he was proposing he wants more movement. And I don't think that came across in the film. The film to me was very negative. But then thinking about it afterwards of what was this man really trying to say, I think that he's asking for a movement. And all the films today in the industry are about the end of the world. So that's obviously something we are all feeling. And that's sort of reflected in his film. He just doesn't say it. I mean, what do you guys think he was trying to do with this film?
Honestly, for me, it was a compilation. It was an essay. It was an essay on Los Angeles filmmaking. There are points I don't agree with, but I think he did a fantastic job, beautiful job of shooting 100, actually putting together an essay for 169 minutes. You know, he went through thousands of hours on YouTube just looking up stuff. You know, I mean, you totally can. For me, I expected more. You know, personally, a documentary is composed of interviews. You know, you're cutting, you're composing the score, you're doing all the legwork. At this point, I just feel like he took films and talked about what he liked and he didn't, which that's basically what he did.
You didn't really like much. You like you liked Dragnet.
In Chinatown.
Yeah. In Chinatown.
Yeah.
No, he didn't like much, but I saw that he was a true fan of film. To be able to go through and reference so many films and how they portray LA. And how they portray LA in the wrong way. He must have a love for his city as well. So this is a guy who loves where he comes from, and he doesn't really like how it's been portrayed to the world. But when I was watching it, I'm thinking, you know, from an outside perspective, when I think of Los Angeles, I think entertainment industry.
Right.
Right? And Bobby, you mentioned how Andersen mentions 1 in 40 are in the entertainment industry here. And I think that's quite a lot. Mm-hmm. Quite a lot of people to be 1 out of 40 working entertainment. I mean, that's pretty a defining feature of your city. All these movies are coming out of this city, and that's just what it's become. I don't think he enjoys what it has become, because what it used to be was a bunch of different boroughs of different cities that eventually got molded together into this one uniform, just LA, whatever LA means. Now to the outsider, it's just LA. Oh, LA. Mm-hmm. It's where there's crime. And there's struggle, but there's also Hollywood. Which he goes on about that. We can hit Hollywood in a second. but, you know, I think if I were to watch it from another perspective, it would be embracing the entertainment industry and not trying to tear it down. Mm-hmm. And he says the hardest thing about the filmmakers struggle to portray LA because we only really know one part of it, you know? And it's always been tapped into way too much. There's too many parts of LA to show to make Los Angeles just one entity. Yeah. There's too many people and there's too many cultures and there's too much going on to really show it all in one film. And so when he breaks down each film and how they can't get it right, I mean, who can blame the filmmakers?
And to go further than that, I think you actually have to blame Andersen for not accounting for the filmmakers. And what I mean is, because there's so many different LAs, if you asked each of us or each of the viewers to say, list the 10 major things about LA, we're all going to list 10 different things.
Right.
And every one of these filmmakers has their own perspective on LA. And so when he says, this film, I didn't like the way they did this, I didn't like the way they did this, you know, whatever, that's the director or the filmmaker, the writer, whoever's perspective on how they have seen LA. It may not be Andersen's. That doesn't make it right or wrong, you know? Mm-hmm. And it would have been one thing, to your essay point, this would have been a better college dissertation.
Yeah. Which is, we have to touch on that because he was actually a professor at the California Institute of the Arts. Mm-hmm. So, you know, anyways.
He should have published a paper on this. It would have been fascinating.
Well, he's actually working on a book.
Yeah.
On the film that further dives into what he was trying to get to. And he admits that maybe the film's a bit out of date because it was written in 2001, filmed in 2003. Right. This is 12 years later, and he said the attitudes have changed now, and that there are films that are appreciating LA's architecture. So maybe, you know, he did get what he wanted a little bit, is that there were movements, there was change in the way that people were viewing LA in their films. I mean, I sat there, and it was hard for me to actually get through the film because I was sitting there in disagreement. I wasn't embracing what he was trying to tell me, and that's why it was difficult. But I think if I would watch it again, with looking into things that he said and realizing it was coming from the place of wanting change in our society, I think I could appreciate it more now.
There's an old saying in filmmaking, those who can't criticize or critique. Mm-hmm. And that's what I felt he did. I felt, you know, he didn't want to put in the legwork. I mean, don't get me wrong. I think he did, he did a fantastic job of going through footage, of seeing stuff already made. He didn't go through the process of actually filming, of, you know, doing the interviews and the legwork. So, you know, he did what was easiest for him.
Yeah, how would you, Thom, make LA look on your film?
Yes. Right.
And let's see you do that, and then I'm going to tell you why your LA is not my LA. And there's nothing wrong with your LA, just like there's nothing wrong with my LA, just like there's nothing wrong with Chinatown's LA, just like there's nothing wrong with Dragnet's LA. You know, it's every one of these perspectives. And the one very, very good point he made that he didn't touch on enough was race and economic class
right.
in LA.
Mm-hmm.
Those are things that are not as objective maybe as we'd like, or whatever, universally understood as we would like, but they're more objective than what do you think of LA? Because the way that, you know, African Americans and Hispanic Americans were portrayed in films 40 and 50 years ago was crappy.
Yeah.
That's not up for debate. Let's talk about that and how that is portrayed and how that has developed, you know?
Right.
And at the very end, he touches on it. And I'm like, okay, this is a 20-minute section I really agree with. Oh, film's over.
Yeah.
That's it.
Yeah.
You know, that would have been so much more valuable to hit on that, hit on the way people are portrayed rather than talking about the architecture and the city. All those things are interesting, but buildings can't talk back.
Right.
Okay. We all have our own perspective on what a building is, on what a, you know, a city block looks like, on whatever a monument means to us. They can't talk back like a person can, or a race, or a class of people. So it's easier, I think, to criticize buildings and architecture and the way LA as a city is portrayed because it's so esoteric, because you can say, oh, well, this is the way LA is and this is the way they portrayed it, because who's going to argue? The
right.
city can't talk back.
Mm-hmm.
If you talk about, well, this is the way they portrayed black people can say, hey, no, we have a say in this.
Right.
We're in this conversation. That's a more valuable conversation to have.
I think that he's actually really enthusiastic about architecture because he's writing a book on that as well. So it's like, that's why he chose this perspective. And like I said, I think he's lacking a few points about what he was really trying to say. And with this demographic, I mean, we can't read minds. A lot of times, you know, I watch films and I'm like, if they would have just were a little clearer with what they were trying to say. I mean, he talks about it in a very poetic Shakespearean way sometimes, where you don't even have time to think about what he's saying, because then he's saying the next point, you know? And it's beautiful, but this isn't a college class. We don't have time to break it down unless you're coming to Popcorn Talk to listen to us talk about it, which you definitely should. You know, people just watching the movie for fun, they don't have time to reflect on what he's really saying. And I heard him say in an interview that I watched that he's hoping that the film finds another place besides YouTube, because that's where it is right
Netflix.
Now. So if you guys haven't seen it, go to YouTube and watch
Netflix.
Los Angeles Plays itself or on Netflix. But also, I think he wants it to be televised. I think he wants, I'm not sure, because he does admit it's outdated.
What
so
does he want, though?
He wants a change. Well, that's what he said. His main point, somebody in the
Thom,
Q in
tell
the
us Q&A, what you want.
In the Q&A that I saw, people were confused by the end.
Ooh.
And
it just ended.
Yeah, that may be jumping ahead, but he was saying that was his call for neorealism. People, he said, now in LA, unions used to be hated, but now they're becoming more popular. He said, fast food workers are now asking for $15 an hour, but before they get that, maybe when we go to fast food restaurants, we can tip the workers. So he has all these good messages. The way he portrayed them in the film didn't get me.
But even that, he jumps from talking about the way LA is portrayed in film to tipping fast food workers.
Mm-hmm.
Not that these aren't both important points, but how do you make that jump in the first place? And I know the Q&A, I'm sure there was a progression
right.
up to that. But that's
right.
kind of my point. You're jumping from thing to thing, and it's like, whoa, whoa, whoa. What's your thesis? What's your one main point? Make it and among other things. If you make one main point, you don't make a 3-hour movie.
And actually, honestly, I think this is a really good point to invite Andersen to come to the show, and, you know, sit here and discuss with us your film. Because honestly, I think you're a brilliant man. Yeah. I think you spend a lot of time, you know, doing what you love to do, but I didn't get it.
Oh, no, and there were 800 things I liked. This is my favorite one we've done so far.
Mm-hmm.
There were 800 things I liked. I really liked it. Seeing all the archive footage is awesome. He's exhaustive in how he does it. He certainly doesn't cut corners in what he picks and what he sees and stuff. But at the end of the day, I'm like, wait a second. What's the one main point? You don't like how it's portrayed? How do you want it to change? What's your contention of how it should change? What's the one thing? Give me the one thing.
And you know what? Maybe it's because there is no one main point. Just like how he can't figure out what exactly Los Angeles is. You can't find the identity for Los Angeles mm-hmm. itself. His film kind of expresses that in and of itself. There is really no point. It kind of jumps around a little bit. There's a little bit of culture here and there's a little bit of architecture there, but there's really no true identity, just like his film itself.
Then I would argue to that, if there is, and I think that's a good point, that there may not be one main point, don't editorialize. You know, don't give us so much of your perspective about how LA is most portrayed. I'm a native. You transplants don't know. Don't give me that if you don't have the main point. If LA is too confusing, just be honest about it and say, you know what? LA is a smorgasbord of crap. Everybody's going to do something different.
And he kind of says that too. He says LA is a destination. It's not a place. It's not a resort. And it's not even really a city anymore. It's a jungle that you walk through. Mm. It's not somewhere you end up. You know, even when, you know, people are making the films, he's saying LA is so ambiguous that it can play any city.
Right.
Well,
that's quite true, actually. I mean, he goes on to point out a couple of films and, you know, like Chicago, for example, I think, what was it, Public Enemy or something.
Or Switzerland.
Right, Switzerland, which was Calabasas.
Yeah.
I mean, LA is so diverse in everything, you know, culture-wise, scenery, you name it, it's there.
Well, he talks about LA as a character, and then he talks about LA as the subject itself. Right. And when he's talking about LA as a character, he does bring up, he does give tribute to some of the buildings. He kind of juggles his appreciation and his disdain at the same time for these buildings. He loves the architecture, but he hates how they're used in films. You know, even though, you know, I feel like the best scenes should be seen by people who can't see them in person. That's why we put them in films.
Right.
Well, he was saying he got a lot of his influences and opinions for this film by reading the newspapers and living here. Now, those are completely two different things to me. I avoid the newspapers. I avoid the media because if I wanted to go see something that was fictional, I would see a movie instead. And I think that that's sort of the wrong thing to say, is tell people that you got these ideas about your film from the newspapers, because a lot of times the newspaper is entertainment. It's just trying to sell itself too.
Yes.
So how do you guys feel about an unreliable narrator in this case?
It's confusing, honestly.
Yeah.
I mean, you can tell, you know, that he has major love for LA, mm-hmm. Los Angeles. You know, he spent, what, 15, 20 minutes on the Bradbury building?
I mean, which
seriously.
I need to go visit after that.
We can show.
Yeah. We can show the Bradbury building.
It's beautiful. Okay. And now I want to go see it.
Yeah, absolutely.
And you're talking about whether or not we can trust him. And like I said, coming from an outside perspective, I don't know LA the way he does, so I kind of have to as the viewer. You know, and he says filmmakers themselves, they are the tourists coming in. They don't understand LA enough to accurately represent it. Well, as a viewer, I don't understand the truth or the lies that you're showing me. Mm-hmm. All I understand is I'm seeing a film.
Exactly.
Oh, there we go.
There we go.
But you know, this is Angel's Flight.
This is Angel's Flight, which he also had much appreciation for, but just like Los Angeles changes, Angel's Flight doesn't exist anymore except as a tourist attraction. Mm-hmm. So it seems like the truest parts about the historic LA don't exist anymore except to appease people because they've seen them in films.
Right.
And he says the old parts of LA don't exist anymore.
Yeah,
the new parts that were in films are now the old, and they're the tourist attractions. And this is the Bradbury Building. And it's beautiful. It was shown in
as a hospital, office buildings. It could be anything.
It could be anything. And
It really can. I mean, it's amazing. I haven't been there, but I've seen it in many films. And honestly, I mean, it's beautiful. You cannot sit there and say this is not amazing. The architecture is incredible. If you have a high budget, you can shoot anything you want.
Right.
You know?
And that's kind of the thing. Is another problem that I had with him is he discounts all of this. He discounts the logistics. LA is a town where the film industry happens to be You know, the one in 40 is there. Mm-hmm. These people don't always, especially in the past, couldn't always travel onto location.
Right.
You weren't going to film a movie in Switzerland in the 30s. You had to stay here. And so you fit things to make it work in your film. In his entire deconstruction of the way LA is portrayed and the way it looks like Chicago and Switzerland and whatever else, it totally ignores the fact that logistics, economics, these people are trying to make films on a budget. You can't, what do you want to do? You can't always go on location. You know, it's ignorant. It's completely ignorant to that aspect of filming. He just looks at the art, valuable. You also have to look at the business side. For better or worse, you got to do it. And he didn't.
Yeah.
It's pretty hypercritical of other filmmakers.
I think it is. And that's good. And you can be critical. Lord knows, I know you can be critical. And that's fine. But it's just, you have to acknowledge every point. If you're not going to acknowledge every point, and at least say, at least acknowledge, you know what? There's a business side to this I'm not going to talk about. Say that.
Right.
At least tell us that so we know you've considered it while you deconstruct the artistic side.
That's a great point. I mean, that's a very valid point. I don't know how I would do it. I think I'd probably take a little bit more time and maybe edit it differently. Mm-hmm. But, you know, it's a very valid point. It all comes down to logistics. You know, how much, what's your budget? Where can you shoot? And, you know, how can you tell the best story and do justice to the landscape?
I feel like the films he was talking about, though, he really did like. I mean, they were epic films that he mentioned. I mean, Sunset Boulevard is one of my favorites that he mentioned. But some people were asking if he had any issues getting rights to show the films. And he said that under Fair Use Copyright Act, as long as he quoted them, he didn't have issues. And he did write to Warner Brothers for asking to use one of the films, but never got a response. So he didn't like the way the studios were handling the people because it wasn't a big budget film. So it's like, I think that just kind of aggravated
there's
him
a bias.
Even more.
Exactly. There's a bias to acknowledge. We all have biases, but there's one to acknowledge. You know, how does he then maybe go after the Warner Brothers films because they didn't respond to
right.
And he perceives it as a slight, and then all of a sudden a Warner Brothers film is crapped on in this film, you know?
Well, you know, I mean, well, that's how he took advantage of the fair use.
Yeah.
He said, okay, I'll reach out to them, and if they reach back, then great. But if not, I mean, it's fair use. As long as I give them credit, it's okay. And I can do that to anybody's film, which I don't think it's cool. I mean, honestly, mm-hmm. I think if you're going to speak negatively about a film, you should give somebody else the opportunity to defend it. You know?
Oh, I'm all for speaking negatively about it because we are, and he's not here. For example,
right?
I'm all for speaking negatively about it.
He's over there on the couch.
But we just gave him an invitation to come out and join us.
I just think if you're going to speak negatively about it, at least acknowledge the other side. It's that same. It's that old third grade compare and contrast. Mm-hmm. Write your essay, but you do have to do that. Acknowledge the strong points or acknowledge where your argument lacks. Because when you don't acknowledge that,
we're going to
you lose me. Yeah, you lose me. And I think, wait a second, you don't know everything. You didn't acknowledge where you come short. You don't know everything.
He did. In the Q&A that I watched, and that's why that's why my love for the film deepened after watching that Q&A, because it's like, you should have redone the film and included this kind of stuff, because you can't have a one-sided documentary. I don't think you can. You have to be that unbiased view and let the viewer make up their mind, but he didn't do that from beginning to end. And another interesting point that he mentioned is he didn't include any Valley films, because when he was making this, he said that he felt like the Valley was sort of separating itself from LA, so he left out films like Ridgemont High and Magnolia, which he would have loved to have in, but his prediction was that the Valley was separating itself from Los Angeles.
Why? Is it because it was the porn capital of the world? Or
I wasn't there to ask him the question, but no, I just think that, you know, this is a man who has his ideas, and he obviously is not asking a lot of people if they agree with them.
Right.
He's just putting them out there. And in the Q&A, you could tell that he spoke very slowly. And when people asked him about his negative views or whatever, it took him a very long time to come up with a response, and it went on tangents, much like the film. Mm. And so I think that he doesn't have a clear view of exactly what he wants to say, but you can see he's thinking, and he's open-minded, and he's admitting that attitudes change. His attitude changes. So this is just sort of a timepiece, maybe, at that point, that doesn't stand true today, that we can acknowledge.
Well, you know, I have a bit of a problem with it, and it's mostly because of his background. You know, I touched on the little bit that he's a former professor at the California Institute of the Arts. As a professor, I should have been able to, you know, any viewer should have been able to understand exactly what he was talking about. You lost me.
I'm not a student of film. I'm not from LA, and you know, I feel like I kind of understood where he was coming from, but not where he was going. You know.
Okay.
He didn't have a point to make. It was just a rant. He was just had all these bottled up emotions. I could tell this guy just went through probably 30 years of his life watching all these movies and just finally just needed just to purge it out of his system, right. Just to sweat it out. Mm-hmm. And you know what? That's fine. You know, we watched it.
This was a 3-hour long hot take. Is what it was, right?
169 minutes. But honestly, how did you feel about the fact that he said, you know, first of all, like he opens the film with, I'm from L.A. and I have the right to do this.
Here's the thing. No one's from L.A.
Exactly.
You when you say something like that, yeah, Los Angeles. No, screw it. I'm calling it L.A. When you say, because I'm not from here. Yeah. When you say something like, I'm the native, I'm from L.A., you're all excluding. The stuff he's talking about, not only are you excluding, you're ignorant to the history and the history of what Americans called manifest destiny in the 19th century coming across the Western United States. No one landed here. Columbus did not land here. You know, Americans were not here. American Indians were here. And before that, nobody was here.
Actually,
if you go back far enough.
Mexico, Santa Ana.
Exactly.
I hate you.
And there's a lot of history here that is not American. And then there's a lot of history here of every Caucasian American that looks like him or looks like us or whatever. All these people came here. They immigrated at one point or another. So you, Thom Andersen, when you say I'm from here, you're making limited generational argument. I'm here because my parents had me, you know, I was born here from my parents. Okay, but your parents were not. You know, LA is a migrant city and it always has been. This was created by migrants, by dreamers coming to the West Coast, by the gold rush, by whatever else is going on. And the film industry and every other industry grew out of that. So it's ignorant to be like, I can speak differently because I'm from here. Right. When really, even a couple generations back, every one of us is an immigrant.
To be fair, in the beginning of the film, he did say, living here sometimes I feel that gives me the privilege right. or the right to critique. So he is saying I feel this way sometimes, not necessarily this is my right, you know. So he definitely admits to possibly not being the narrator that you can trust in the beginning, and I didn't pay that much attention to that,
right.
But also, this kind of reminds me of The Network and the message of just being, I'm mad as hell and I'm not going to take this anymore, you know? I think that's kind of him, like, shouting out. That's how I saw this movie. What were some good points that you guys liked about this movie?
The socioeconomic thing at the end, race and class. Mm-hmm. The way race and class is, the other good point he talks about, no one walks in L.A. No one takes the bus. Mm. And he's right about this. No rich white person walks.
Well, white people.
That's the thing. That's a fair point, that when you say no one walks, you completely discount a class of people. That stuff like that should have been explored more. And stuff like that people need to know, because the perception of L.A. is it's a car city. Everything looks like Beverly Hills, which is obviously incorrect.
It doesn't.
Everybody drives a nice car and does whatever, and we sit on the 405. And the buses, how many people do you guys know that take the bus routinely?
You know, honestly...
that's the thing. We're getting a little bit away from...
From the subject of the film.
From the subject of the film, which is that movies betray their native city. The films that are made in L.A. are betraying the actual real depiction of L.A. I mean, we're not really talking about the history of Los Angeles and the cultural struggles that it's been through.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we're not watching a historical film. We're watching a critical film rant.
An essay.
Yeah, an essay about how the movies that portray Los Angeles aren't portraying Los Angeles in the right way.
So do you mean like all that race and socioeconomic stuff doesn't fit in this film?
It does when it comes to films that are about it.
Yeah.
When he's talking about the other films that show the neorealism of the cultures that have struggled, he actually praises them. Those are the only films that he says actually depict what LA really is and kind of where it's come from and the realism of it. He says the only people who truly know LA walk the streets mm-hmm. and ride the buses, and yes, that may be true. So when you're showing a film from their perspective, then you're showing the true LA.
So is he saying that he did all that? Because I doubt it.
He might have walked down
honestly
the street.
And don't discount the fact that when he mentions those three African-American filmmakers, he loves to argue with filmmakers and yell at filmmakers, you're not from here, you don't know LA like I do. And then those three African-American filmmakers who have neorealism that he loves are, and he admits, are from Ethiopia, Mississippi, and Texas.
Wow.
So you're hating that, you know, non-natives until you get a few non-natives you agree with. Then these guys totally have it right.
Well, he was talking about how people who come from far away, the foreign filmmakers, often tap into those untapped parts of LA because, you know, they get here and they see it differently than we do. So that was interesting to me. What do you have to say?
He said, I remember watching the film, he mm-hmm. said, the parts that we don't like, that's what the foreign filmmakers portray as beautiful things or something along those lines. And I think that's what we're talking about when he says, you have these directors coming from London and they're, you said, just what?
Well, I mean,
it's like a high tourism perspective.
Yeah,
right.
High tourism perspective. But
when you get the perspective of the underclass who goes through the real struggles that mm-hmm. are happening in the cities of Los Angeles, in the city, I guess I would say cities of Los Angeles,
right.
Then you have a perspective that's more low tourism and real mm-hmm. and actually represents the city that he wants to be represented more accurately in the world. But the thing is, he mentions how, okay, we have this perspective of the low and downtrodden and the cultures, the black cultures, the Hispanic cultures who have gone through all these troubles, right? And that's the accurate depiction of Los Angeles. But he also makes a point that, you know what, it is hard to make a personal story from the perspective of the privileged. Because mm-hmm. if you want to make a perspective of Los Angeles from the rich white man, you know, you can't show a personal story with conflict and troubles because the problems either seem like petty or pathetic mm-hmm. and you don't want to watch it. So you can't get that perspective from the privileged. You can only really get the true, honest perspective from the troubled. And that's a struggle I think filmmakers have.
I don't know. I don't really agree. I agree with you to some extent. But I think, you know, we're talking about the privileged kind of like not having the right to make those kind of films. I think to an extent they do have an idea of what happens. You know, a lot of those people do make a lot of positive things and they make a lot of things happen. And I think that a lot of them are connected and are in touch with what happens in the city. Their socioeconomic status should not, you know, invalidate what they do and what they cannot do. Again, I just think
the problems
needed more work.
Well, I mean, but then you take the problems of the privileged, and if they're not petty or pathetic, then they're outrageous and extravagant, and they become like these cop thrillers, and then they become this inaccurate depiction of Los Angeles, which is what his whole problem with the filmmakers are, you know, is.
Yeah.
And that just goes back to every single human in Los Angeles has a perspective on this town mm-hmm. that is their own, mm-hmm. and when they make a film about it, that perspective is carried into that film for better or worse.
Right.
Nothing, ideas are universal. When you want to relate to a film, you have to have a universal idea that everybody can grasp in the broadest sense, but portrayals are not universal, right? So every portrayal of a character we'll see differently, and every portrayal of a city, which is a character according to him, which I kind of agree with, every portrayal of Los Angeles is going to be different because mm-hmm. the perspective is different. My experience with Venice Beach is different from your experience with Venice Beach. And if you asked both of us to make films about Venice Beach, we'd mm-hmm. come up with very different things.
Right.
And that's cool.
What an amazing film that would be if he would have chosen to just use the compilation of giving, you know, four people a camera and asking them to go shoot LA.
Yeah, go show me
LA.
Los Angeles.
And then you bring the footage and he's going to say you're wrong.
Yeah.
No. Yeah, probably.
No, he admits that this is his opinion, you know? Like, we can't hate on him. He admits, hey, this is my opinion. This is the way I see it. This isn't necessarily the way everybody else is going to see it. He says, I'm doing Los Angeles instead of New York, Chicago, because I know Los Angeles. That's why I'm picking this city. He's not like just picking on Los Angeles instead of New York, you know? So it's like, we can't be mad at this guy.
No.
He's saying this is my opinion. So he's not a rotten person.
He's not.
Know?
And honestly, I mean, you know, I don't hate him. I really do admire a lot of his work.
Mm-hmm.
I don't agree with it. You know, I think he did a great job, but you know, I'm not hating it.
Maybe he did his job because you don't agree with it.
And that's true. I think he probably did do a good job, you know, because you brought up that valid point. You know, we're sitting here talking about the film, so obviously he accomplished something.
Yeah, he did something right.
So
whatever it is.
I just think to a certain extent, it's interesting to have him do this. And I want to know what you guys think, because to a certain extent, after watching this, I've kind of realized that his film is almost an exercise in futility because it's so subjective. Mm. It's interesting to discuss all this stuff and start thinking about it. But at the end of the day, is his portrayal or his criticism of the portrayal of L.A. going to change my perspective on L.A.? No, because I have my own unique one, and you guys do too. So does his film, will his film or anything like it change anything in the industry?
I think that it's not necessarily meant to change any of our perspectives. He did this on purpose. Right. He wants to create a reaction. He wants us to think about his film. He wants us to think about what he wants, what he's asking for is a change. It's not supposed to change our perspective. Of course not. But
our perception, I think, is what he wants us to do.
No, I don't even
open
know.
Up.
Maybe, but I think he's asking for a movement. And this film obviously made us all feel something.
Yes.
And in order to take action, the first step that needs to occur in
reaction.
A person is a trigger. You need to be triggered by something. This film triggers us. It triggered all of us. So to say that it doesn't change my perspective may be true, because we are all going to see LA the way we want to. That's our choice. But I think that it's going to trigger me to want to do something more. You know, because I already feel it.
It triggers me to double down on my own portrayal of L.A. because mine is mine.
That's
you know, it triggers me to do the exact opposite thing that I think he probably wanted, which is weird.
My only perception of Los Angeles was the ones I got from watching it on TV and watching it in movies. And that's the thing, is most of the people in the world, when they think of Los Angeles, they have this tunnel vision of what it is. And I think what he's trying to do is break down the walls and just give you more of a peripheral view of what the city. See, that's the thing, is I can't think of Los Angeles as one city anymore. It's a bunch of cities that came together and gave itself one name. But LA is so much bigger than what everyone thinks it is, which is a you know, busy, corrupt town that makes movies. And he breaks that down, and for me at least, a newcomer to the city, my perspective or my perception of it has been widened. And I think he would, I don't know, hopefully take some solace in the fact that had that effect on me.
You know, I think a good point to make is that the films he showed are big budget films. You know, they were all big budget films. You didn't see a lot. Well, I don't actually remember watching any indie stuff.
He showed a couple of very, very few small budget stuff.
That's probably zoned out.
Yeah.
but honestly, I mean, indie filmmakers go to the extent of shooting in low budget places. For example, you know, I don't ride the buses, but I did for a very long time here in LA. Been here for 7 years. But since then, you know, I go on hikes, maybe not every day, as obviously you can tell. I run through the canals of LA, you know, especially Culver City. I go to the Hollywood sign.
Which has more studios than anywhere else.
Very true. Very true. But I think, you know, the indie filmmakers are the ones who have more of an appreciation or able to show more because of the lack of budget. You know, you have to make something happen with whatever you have, whatever resources you make. So, you know, you portray it as you can. And I think
he had great appreciation for those lower budget indie films that had more of a realism. When someone walks out of a building, they're shown walking out of that same building and not 5 or 10 miles away, which he really didn't like. He didn't like when filmmakers were experimenting with the city. Because it's so ambiguous, you can get away with it, but not through his eyes, the trained eyes of a true Los Angeles.
Los Angelino.
But I don't know. He has some pretty true points. I've only lived here a little bit, but what he said, the best films about LA, at least partly, are about modes of transportation. Getting from place to place is not a given. And
well, being stuck in the 405 or in the 10 and the 5 in the middle of the traffic,
even with a car, it's not a given.
Well, I made a list of the films that he did critique, the ones that really looked interesting to me. What I hated was the fact that he showed, like, the most epic part of each of these films. Because I'm like, oh my gosh, why is he showing this part? This ruins it for people who haven't seen the film. That was maybe Sunset Boulevard. I'm not sure. But I'm just like, there were quite a few where I was like, if you really love film, you want people to watch these films. Not ruin them for them.
I think he assumed everybody has watched these films, because I've watched most of these, at least most of the big ones like Sunset Boulevard. I think his assumption was, coming in, you've seen these films, now let's break them down. You know,
but I'm not sure. I think if you live in LA, you've seen those films. If
probably.
I show this documentary to anyone in my hometown in Pennsylvania, they have absolutely not seen it, and they haven't seen any of those films you mentioned.
Well, maybe not most of them, but I think some of them. Sunset Boulevard is a classic.
Right.
You know,
I'm talking about, maybe they've seen one or two, but like...
The Pushover, 1954. The Savage, 1960. The Savage Eye, 1960. I mean... I never saw those before.
I've never seen Blade Runner.
You gotta watch it.
Guys, next week we'll be reviewing Blade Runner.
You gotta watch a lot of TCM to know these films that he's talking about.
Yeah. And honestly, that's a niche market. Yeah. Not a lot of people watch that niche market. And you're right. You know, he came from a perspective of, I know cinema, I know film. Mm-hmm. You know, this is me giving you my point of view. But he did forget about those of us who... maybe you're a bit novice in cinema and filmmaking. You know, we haven't had the classical training of going back. Actually, you know, Hitchcock, I think those are films that you should have watched already by now. And
push
if not,
pause, go watch Psycho. Come back.
You know, but I think one of the successes that his documentary had, that Andersen really did very well, he gave me all these titles of films. And honestly, even though his point of view was a bit, you know, not
one-sided,
it did give me a list of films that I want to go watch and I want to go and rent out and say, hey, okay, I want to check these out. Because even though he portrayed the best, you know, the best little pieces of film, of the film, I want to see what the film's about. You know, even though he gave us his point of view.
In the back of my head, in each of these films now, I'm going to be thinking, is that really Los Angeles? Is that really LA?
Well, he gives this line. He says, movies lie about LA sometimes, and we wish these lies were real. How do you guys feel about that?
I think movies lie about everything sometimes. Yeah. We just wish those lies were real. Welcome to the movies. That's why you engage in a fantasy for 2 hours. What did you expect? Mm-hmm. You know, there's only so much neorealism you want to watch. Well, at one point you want to watch How to Lose a Guy in 10 Days. Like, you want to watch something that you know is going to end well, or that's going to be a mindless thing. You know,
that's why you were late.
Yeah, you just want. You know, there's a point of taking it seriously to deconstruct it, which is phenomenal, and then there's a point of taking it a little too seriously, and he flirts a little too much with that line.
Right, I agree with that.
So I don't know. I think, and this is going to sound really dumb as a critique and really simple, and I'm sure you can deconstruct it a lot, and I hope people do, but he has to remember that film is also fun. Even drama, even serious films are fun. It's fun to make them. It's fun to tell stories. And I think he discounts that along the way in this hypercritical perspective.
And he takes it so personally.
Yes.
I don't think he's coming from the perspective of someone who's ever made a film that wasn't a documentary. I think that would really change him, because a lot of people who don't know LA, I don't think that they understand the film industry. You have to really have been in the production side of things to really get a film and to appreciate all the parts of it and to understand the fun parts of it, that it doesn't always necessarily have to be great film to enjoy it.
Right. It's almost, he's talking about car chases, how a car would, you know, veer off of Ventura and end up on Melrose. How dare you? And I'm sitting here watching, like, I don't know. I'm thinking, what makes sense?
For people who don't know, he was saying that you'd come out of one door and you'd end up 30 miles elsewhere. So he would shoot, movies obviously have indoor locations in studios, and then when they shoot outdoor, it's not like you're walking out of the studio building and that's where you end up on Melrose. It's often that you're somehow playing with magic and you're like
movie magic.
Yeah. And you're walking out and you're 30 miles somewhere else. So
the movie. Come on, take it easy.
We got to show this guy a good time.
No, right? I don't know. I enjoy. You know, now from now on, when I'm watching movies, and I think I'm gonna start noticing a lot about what he pointed out. There were some things that weren't so hypercritical and just more observational, like how the buildings change with the times. Especially ones like gas stations and grocery stores. You can tell about what era the movie is taking place in based on what the gas station pumps look like, or when you're inside the grocery store, what kind of products they have. You know, just like the clothes and just like the cars, how they change with the times. Right. Los Angeles has been evolving ever since it came here, it got here, just like every other city in the world. So just how the city changes, so do the films. And I'm going to be noticing all those little changes now when I watch.
So he did his job.
You did good. You did good, kid. You got me.
What do you guys think the perspective of others is of LA?
Having talked to a lot of people about this, much more beautiful than it is. LA is ugly as hell. And when everyone comes here, I mean, it is, except for pockets of Santa Monica and Beverly Hills. LA is ugly. There's trash on the ground. There's homeless people all over, which is a product of a lot of different situations.
What area are you living in?
This and is your Koreatown. Tour guide, kids at home. Bobby's going to be your tour guide for Los Angeles. Book
what about
tickets.
Disneyland?
talk to visitors about Hollywood before they travel to Hollywood. Ooh. They're in for a shock.
You Hollywood is not.
There's our documentary. So we buy people tickets to Los Angeles who have never been here. We ask them, what do you think of LA before you get there? And then after it's all over, we'll get, you know, their interview.
You know, gee,
do you feel like you need a shower?
I have to say, I agree with you to some point, to an extent. When I first got here, the first thing I wanted to do is go to Hollywood. And when I got to Hollywood, I wanted to get out. You know,
I'd have to agree with you. Coming from an outside perspective, it was very novel. Right? When you're walking in, there's like four or five Spider-Mans. They're all dirty looking, and they're all just like...
And they all want money.
Yeah, Mickey and Minnie, you can tell they're sweating inside there. You know? And it's... But, you know, any reference to the Walk of Fame, as it should be called, the Walk of Shame, you know, he really didn't like Hollywood. But he didn't have a problem with the Hollywood sign, which I thought was... pretty fascinating. Yeah. He was like,
Or the palm trees.
Yeah, or the palm trees, which, you know, without the palm trees, I would have to say that Los Angeles wouldn't have the magic that it seems to have.
I have to defend the actors, though. You mentioned if you go to Hollywood, you'll see four, you know, Spider-Man guys. These are all Hollywood actors. You know,
Or bums who find a Spider-Man costume and put it on. Like, I'm not seeing performances. Nobody's dancing. They're just walking around taking selfies with people. Honestly, I think there probably was a magical, you know, at Hollywood Boulevard.
But isn't that the beauty of Hollywood? Honestly, I mean, you see all these guys.
I think there's a lot of cool stuff going on all the time. There's red carpets. There's really cool. You see these tour buses driving. I'd really like to take a tour in one of these tour buses to see what they're talking about. But you're right. I think the perspective, the perception of Hollywood and Los Angeles is put on a pedestal. And when you actually get here, it's because your expectation was so high that you feel like you're cheated a little bit and kind of, you know, it's like you're kind of disappointed. Even though, honestly, the city's not that bad. It might be a little dirty, but, you know, any busy city's going to be.
Here's what I'm going to say. We all aren't from here, and we chose to stay. We came from somewhere else. We didn't go home. So I'm sorry, but that speaks volumes about the city, and I'll defend it till I die. I love this city. I'll never move. Yes. You know, I came here from the East Coast, and I fell in love. And if I'm just with LA for the rest of my life, I'm happy. And I think that if we ignore that, we're doing an injustice to the city.
Yes. L.A.
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 Los Angeles.
L.A. Los Angeles. No, I have to say, you're right. You know, I've lived, you know, in several places. But honestly, the first time I arrived to Los Angeles, L.A., I felt like I was home. I knew I had arrived. And I don't want to go anywhere. Mm-hmm. No matter how filthy the city may be portrayed or whatever, you know, L.A. is home.
There's always something to do. I mean, you can go take a hike in the mountains, and you can go surfing their very same day. You can go to a movie premiere, and then you can
go skiing.
Yeah, you can go visit some historical buildings, whether or not they're recognizable to the public or not. You can find magic because it is here.
And even on that note, in an even broader sense, there's always a like-minded community no matter who you are.
Yes.
If you want to go to Los Feliz and hang out with hipsters, you want to go to Hollywood and hang out with weirdos and want to be actors, or go to, you know, Venice and be a surfer beach bum, or go wherever. I mean, there's 50 other ones in these.
All within 5 miles.
Exactly. Yeah. There's a community for literally everything. And really, there's a like-minded community for every race, for every socioeconomic class. They intermingle a little bit. Sometimes they don't. But they're all just right next to each other, you know. And that's something that is unique to very large cities. You'll see the same thing in New York with Chinatown and Little Italy and stuff. But L.A. has this in a weird way. You're going through lots of little towns, and you can be who you want to be in Koreatown one day and in Venice the next, and neither one of those is incorrect.
You know what's going? What's running in the back of my mind? What is Anderson thinking when we're just saying L.A.? Because we're just the whole time you're referencing
what
L.A.
We mean.
L.A.
Yeah, well, you know, we abbreviate it because, the movies taught us that. But also, hello, we all have nicknames. Like, people just abbreviate things because that's the generation we live in. I mean, don't take it as an insult. Yeah. Be fun. But this guy's not fun.
You can call me Issa because of these.
He's looking at things very literal. So, I mean, I don't think calling L.A. is, you know, an insult. No, I mean, most people don't write out New York, let's be honest. And who doesn't love New York?
It's still two syllables, though.
I mean, they literally
so
put...
So it's okay, you can say New York.
Yeah, they literally...
NY and New York are the same syllables, so might as well just say New York. Los Angeles is four syllables, okay? Let's cut it in half.
Okay,
LA.
So we're running out of time, guys.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, is there anything you guys want to end with? Any last reactions to the film?
Come on the show. Anderson, if you're watching this,
it's an invitation.
Yeah, give us a call, shoot us an email, and we'd love to have you and get your point of view. Like,
I think my final reaction is have fun. Like, yeah. Remember, movies are fun. And I know that's a really stupid argument to make because art is serious. But it also does have to be fun. And when you completely discount the fun, you've completely taken away a huge chunk of your audience. Mm-hmm. Have fun. It's okay.
I like that. I like that, Bob.
Yeah.
I'd have to say that, Los Angeles, however it's represented and however it really is, for the good and for the bad, there's a lot to discover. I'm glad that this film opened my eyes to it.
Yeah, I agree. And I want to mention one more line before we go. He talked about nostalgia, LA always being a better place a long time ago. I think nostalgia as a whole is just something we can all agree on is rather an idea and didn't ever exist. It wasn't a reality.
You can't ever go back to the good old days. No matter what it is, no matter what realm it is, you can't go back to the good old days. They didn't exist. Nostalgia is a lie. You're exactly right.
Let's go to the good new days.
Let's go to the future.
To the new days.
To neorealism.
And to LA.
And to social and public change. You guys can follow us at The Popcorn Talk on Twitter, thepopcorntalk.com. You can call in live and talk to us. You can follow me at Cinematic Escape.
And you can find me at Castaneda_Isa on Twitter.com.
And I am at Ryan Malaty.
And I'm on Twitter at Bobby DeMuro.
And we will be live Sundays at 5 p.m. Thanks for tuning in, guys.
Have a good week.
Producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire Popcorn Talk Network. We would like to thank you for tuning in. For questions or comments, be sure to visit popcorntalk.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of the Popcorn Talk Network.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of the Popcorn Talk Network or its owners or principals.